done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered.
My faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your hand.
God, we thank you for being ours this morning, Lord. That even when the waves crash over us, even when life circumstance brings us down, God, your grace is sufficient. Your grace is enough to pull us through, Lord. We thank you for that. We thank you for the power that brings in our lives. We thank you for that sacrifice that your son made, that we can see you even when we're in the water, God, that we have that ability to know what it means to be with you, God. Pray that you would open our hearts and minds this morning as we dig into your word, as we learn about you, God, that we could get closer and closer with you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Church of the Crossroads. My name is John Parkey. I'm the lead pastor here, and I have a really unique ability to remember things from my past and details from my past, and I mean like way back in my past when I was a little kid. And it's kind of unique because my wife can't remember anything from like middle school and earlier, right? Like 13 years old on is what she remembers. She doesn't remember anything about elementary school. I can remember stuff when I was like 4 years old, 3 years old even, some weird little details. Growing up, my dad, and with that, growing up, my dad, to me, was bigger than life. You know what I mean? Like he was very athletic. He ran track. He went to, when he was in high, and I don't remember this because I wasn't born yet, but I'm just filling you some details in. When he was in high school, he went to the Tennessee High School State Championship when he was a senior in track. He was an incredible basketball player, very quick, good ball handler, great jump shot. He was a preacher. So I grew up with my dad as a preacher, and as a preacher, he knew a lot of people, and everywhere we went, people would come up to him, and we'd see somebody that he knew. And so as a kid growing up, like in elementary school or younger, like I was very proud of my dad. You know what I mean? Like I remember things like when I was just 4 years old going to like the park pool, and my dad going off the diving board doing flips, my dad going off the diving board and doing like cannonballs and can openers and trying to splash me and my little brother and my mom on the side of the pool. And I remember like him splashing us and us laughing, and I remember telling somebody, that's my dad, right? I was proud of that. I remember going to watch my dad play like church league basketball, and him like I didn't know it at the time, you would call it this, but he would like be like breaking ankles with this crossover and jump shots, and thinking to myself like that's my dad. I remember being like 7 or 8 years old and throwing baseball in the front yard with my dad and a friend of mine coming over and like a neighborhood kid who's about my age and saying, hey, can I play too? And I remember being like real jealous, like, no, it's just me and my dad. We're just me and my dad. And my dad going, now, John, no, he can play. Go get your brother's glove so he can have a glove and he can play too. But I remember being jealous, like just me and my dad. I remember going to, like after church, we didn't grow up with, we were kind of poor. And so like McDonald's was a treat for us, right? And so on Sundays after church, we would go to McDonald's for lunch. And when we would go to McDonald's, like people from church would come, or there'd be other people in from the neighborhood who'd be there, and people would come up to our table and say like, hey, to our dad, knew our dad's name. And I remember thinking like, my dad knows everybody, like that's my dad. When we're little, everything and everyone seems larger than life, right? Like my dad, and as I grew up, I realized my dad wasn't perfect, but he was good. He was good, but he wasn't a perfect father. Like he had weaknesses and he had struggles, but he was good, and he was around, and he was involved, and he was engaged in our lives, and he loves me very much, and that was obvious, and it still is today. Now, I was fortunate in that way, that I had a father like that. And some of you can relate to my story or my relationship with my father. Some of you, though, on the other hand, have no idea what I'm talking about, right? Like you can't fathom what it's like to have a good father. Some of your fathers were gone. Some of your fathers were not around, or they worked too much, or they didn't have time for you, or they didn't love you, or they were abusive, or they were addicts, or you know what I mean? Like some of you don't know the love of a good father. Now listen, because I had a decent father, that doesn't make me better than you, or you worse than me. That's just the hand that we were dealt, good or bad. And I share all of this with you this morning because this morning we're going to talk about the fatherhood of God. And it's kind of a deep, very important doctrine or idea that we have got to grasp. Because for us, the word father in all of us probably stirs up something a little bit different. It stirs up ideas or memories that are either good or bad or somewhere in between. And for some of us, the idea of God as a father is not even on our radar. Like, we've never even thought of God like that. For some of us, the idea of God as father is either a comforting experience, a terrifying experience, or we're just apathetic about it. But this morning, you need to know that the fatherhood of God, like the idea of God as a father, is absolutely essential and is a fundamental concept that is found all over the scriptures. In his book, Knowing God, J.I. Packer, which when I left the other church I was at and I moved to this church, all my books were stored in the basement. And I don't know if you know this, but hopefully in the next couple weeks we're going to be moving out this way. So we've had that like downsize, and so I think I threw this book away. I read it years ago, but a guy named J.I. Packer wrote a book called Knowing God. It's a classic. Put this on your reader's list if you're a reader. But in this book, he asks the question, what is a Christian? And for all of us, we would probably define that in either extremely different ways or in subtle different ways. Some of you are investigating and wonder what the answer to that question is for yourself. But J.I. Packer says this, what is a Christian? The question can be answered in many ways, but the richest answer I know is that a Christian is one who has God as a father. The foundation of who we are as Christians is this realization and this confident recognition and acceptance that we are sons and daughters of God, of a Father God. And I want you to hang on to that idea for just a minute. We'll come back to that. For those of you who don't know, we've been in this study of the book of Galatians in the Bible. If you have your Bible or if you have a Bible on a device, look up Galatians. We're going to look at Galatians chapter 3. The last 2 weeks we've looked at chapter 1 and we've looked at chapter 2. And it's been kind of deep stuff. It's probably felt like a classroom just a little bit. But we're going to be in chapter 3 today. So we studied through the first two chapters. A guy named Paul wrote this book, and Paul teaches this new church in this book, this area of Galatia. This new church has started, and this is what he taught them, right? He says, you are saved, right? Saved from what? Saved from your sins, right? You are rescued, you are saved from your sins. Saved to what? Saved to the promise of eternal life, being with God forever, being made right with God. So you are saved by grace, right? And grace is not something you earn. It's not something you deserve. Grace is unearned favor, right? So you are saved by grace, God's free gift to you, through faith. So we believe in that. We trust in that. We give ourselves to what Jesus has done. You are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. This is what Paul teaches throughout this book. So what he's saying is, you cannot save yourselves. You cannot prove to God that you are good enough to be saved. The Bible says that none of us are good enough. We've all broken the Ten Commandments, right? Think Ten Commandments. When we use the word law, and we'll use it here a few times this morning, think Ten Commandments when we use the word law. We've all broken all of the Ten Commandments in some way, in some shape or fashion. We've all broken all of them in some way. There is no one good enough to save themselves. You are only saved by trusting and abiding in Jesus. His death on the cross forgives you. His resurrection proves that he is Lord over all things, that he is right about all things. And so faith is, I trust that Jesus is right about everything he says, and so I will abide by everything he says. That's faith. So I put my faith in him. So it's his grace and your faith that save you. That's what saves you. And so last week we talked about this. There are two things at the cross. When Jesus is hanging on the cross, there are two things that are happening. The first one is this. Christ on the cross takes your sin and your rebellion on himself. Like, he becomes sin for you. He takes all of your sin on you, and he receives the punishment and the wrath of God for our evil and wickedness. The second thing that happens is Jesus becomes our sin. We get clothes of righteousness. Like, we get Christ's righteousness. So on the cross, there's like a swap that occurs. So this work of Jesus on the cross isn't just for God's people, the Israelites, the people of the Old Testament, the Jewish people. Jesus' death on the cross, or his work on the cross, is for all people, Jews and Gentiles, right? Jews are the Israelites, God's people who had the Ten Commandments, and which was the law. The Gentiles didn't have the law, right? The Gentiles did not have the Ten Commandments. So the Gentiles did not know right from wrong. They didn't know what it meant to be moral. They were heathens, right? And Paul says to these good Jews who have been trying all their life to obey all the Ten Commandments and all the other laws that are in the Old Testament, Paul says to these good Jews this. He says, you can't be saved because of your good behavior. You can try and try and try, but you, Jews, Israelites, cannot be saved by your good behavior. And those Gentiles that you hate and despise and think are unclean, they can be saved despite their bad behavior. So this is what Paul is teaching. And what he's saying is this. This is good news, because what this means is there is hope. And we say this around here all the time. There is hope for everyone. You can be saved despite your bad behavior. Your sin, your wickedness, like your terrible upbringing and your sinful background. And this is what we say. You're not too broken. You're not too messed up. You're not too far away for God. And so let's get into Galatians chapter 3. It kind of hopefully brings us up to speed. Galatians chapter 3, we're going to look at beginning with verses 23 and 24. We're going to read this, but we're also going to let it read us. That makes sense, all right? So Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 through 24 says, before the coming of this faith, right? This faith meaning now that Jesus is here. Before the coming of Jesus and his death, burial, and resurrection, before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law. We were locked up by the law until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came that he might be justified by faith. So what Paul is doing is helping us understand why he gave the Jewish people the Ten Commandments and all the other laws, right? And we talked a little bit about this last week. God gives his people in the Old Testament the law for a few reasons. And the first one is this. He gives them the Old Testament to set them apart. Like, he gives them the Old Testament to say, these are my people. I'm entrusting them with the law. They will be different. They will be examples to you because of the law. So he gives them the law to set them apart. So he gives them the law to say, they are my chosen people. What are they supposed to do as God's chosen people? They are supposed to bless the entire earth. They're supposed to be a blessing. And so God gives them the law to kind of build a wall around them to set them apart. You are to be different than the rest of those who are living in sin and don't know the difference between good and evil. And so he sets them apart with the law, all right? The second reason he gives them the law is to restrain evil, right? So think about before the Ten Commandments, there was no law, there were no rules. People didn't know what was right from wrong. They were trying to figure it out. And honestly, because there were no rules, they could do whatever they felt like doing. You know what I mean? Like think about that. You could do whatever you want to do. Like in 5 o'clock traffic in Mount Washington, however you feel in that moment is okay because there is no law. You can drive up on the curb, down the sidewalk. You can get out and, you know what I mean? I mean, you can do whatever you want because there are no laws, right? But that wouldn't be good, right? If we were left to our own, like, lusts and desires, if we were left to do whatever it is we wanted to do and however we felt in the moment, we would kill each other. We would just completely destroy each other. So God gives the Ten Commandments, one, to set his people apart. Two, secondly, to begin to restrain evil. Now, it didn't keep the people from sinning. It just kind of curbed lawlessness or sin, all right? The third reason he gives it, and this is what I shared last week, is he gives us the Ten Commandments or he gives us the law to diagnose or reveal the fact that we can't keep the law perfectly. Like God gives the Ten Commandments and he says, here's what a perfect man looks like. Here's what a perfect woman looks like. They obey all of these perfectly. And we can't. If we could, we wouldn't need Jesus, right? We can't be morally perfect. Like we gossip, we slander, we cheat, we lie, we disrespect. We treat others with contempt. We create drama and dysfunction. We get addicted. Like we just cannot not sin. It's just the way it is. The law shows us that. The law shows us that we have a sinful nature, that we can't stop sinning fully or completely. We can try. And so God says, this is what it should look like. Here's the Ten Commandments. We should look at the Ten Commandments, compare it to ourselves, and go, uh-oh. And that's the purpose of the law. So the Ten Commandments and the law show us that we have a need, and that need ultimately should help us draw the conclusion that we need help. We need a remedy. And Paul says that in this passage that we just read, that the law held us in custody, right? And what he means is it protected us, it restrained us, and it guarded us until. And that word until is a word that deals with time, meaning there was a before and there was an after. Like before Jesus, there was the law and it guarded and restrained you and it protected you till Jesus came. So before Jesus, there was the law. The law was important and what you were to live by until Jesus or until the faith that we now have in Jesus. And what Paul's saying is there was a time when things changed. There was a moment when everything changed. Think about it like this. In July, David Parkerson, the guy who did announcements, and myself and a couple others of us from here are going to Guatemala on a mission scouting trip. Like we're trying to find a village, a place where we will set up mission. And then over the course of the next few years, we will go on short-term mission trips, and hopefully you'll be one of those who go with us to Guatemala, right? So in July, we're flying out to Guatemala, so we'll go to the airport in Louisville. And when we get to the airport in Louisville, when Parkerson goes to the airport, his two sons, Rowan and Quinn, will only be able to walk up to the TSA security. That's as far as they can go. They will not be able to go any further through the airport with him than that moment. Like there was a day though where they could have. There was a day where they could have walked all the way back and sat with him at the gate. But we can no longer do that anymore. Do you remember why? Because of 9/11. Like there was a moment that changed everything. And that moment, the 9/11 terrorist attacks, will forever be a moment that is a marked distinction and change the way that we travel through the air in the U.S., right? That moment changed everything. And so similar to that, something changed, something happened in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus that has forever changed the way we relate to each other, the way we relate to the law or the Old Testament or the Ten Commandments, and forever changed the way we relate to God. At Jesus' death, Jesus takes our sin and he receives the punishment that you and I deserve. At his death, then, what he does is he makes a way, he makes us right with God, he reconnects us with God. Are you following me here? Like, before Jesus, there really wasn't a way to be made right with God. And so Paul says, for those who have faith in Jesus now, things have changed. You are saved. Jesus changes everything. You now can come into the presence of God without guilt and without shame because you are forgiven, you are made pure, you are made right because of your faith, and so you are set free from guilt and shame. Changed everything. Let's look at Galatians verses 25 through 28. Paul goes on to say, now that this faith, right, this faith, these are my words, in Jesus, right, now that this new faith, not in the law, but this new faith in Jesus has come, we are no longer under the guardian, the law. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were, what just happened to Carrie up here, what baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. All right? Now, let me break this down just a little bit. Labels, right? There are a lot of labels in this passage right here. Jew, Gentile, slave, free, male, female. Labels. I want to help you understand this, and I want to do this by making you think back to high school. Like that really, for some of you, really painful time in life, or for some of you, like the greatest years of your life, right? Back to high school for a minute. In high school, everyone had some kind of label based on their participation. Or in something, or their lack of participation. Like, there were no labels in elementary school. We were all the same in elementary school. Somewhere in middle school, we started looking to people and dressing a different way and got involved in certain things, and we just kind of, there became these labels, right, for the most part. So in high school, you had the athletes, you had the band, you had the bookworms, you had the cheerleaders, you had, depending on what years, depending on how old you are, why am I pointing over here? You had the hippies, you had the rockers, you had the goths, right? For those of you who grew up in the 90s, you had the skateboarders, Bullitt County, we have the rednecks, the motorheads, you had stoners, druggies, loners, right? The parties, okay. All these labels, and the list goes on and on. Now, when I read that list of labels, as I read that list, there were probably some names of people that came to your mind. And you probably even maybe had a label for yourself, and you know where you fit in that category, in one of those categories of the labels, right? And so at school, there's sort of this unspoken separation for the most part. And some of you, there were these unique people in high school, right, who could just kind of bounce from group to group and befriend all the groups, and they were friends with everybody, but those people were unique, right, most of the time. Most of the time, students just hang out with their own crowd or their own kind. And when you hang out with your own kind, there's sort of this arrogance, and you talk bad about the other people in those other labeled categories, right? You're better than them, or they're stupid, or they're, you know, we get arrogant when we're together with our group. Everyone else is stupid. Everybody else is lame. Blah, blah, blah. High school drama, okay? So the same was true, all these labels, the same was true back in Jesus' day, right? If back in Jesus' day you were rich and you were free, and there were a lot of slaves back in that day, and slaves back in that day were working off a debt for the most part, right? So you, if you were rich and you were free, and listen to this, and you were a man, you were worth something, at least to the culture. And if you were poor, a slave, or a woman, you had no worth, and you could be treated worse than the family pet. Labels and stigma, a lot of judgment and a lot of separation. Not much unlike high school. Are you with me on this? Okay. So there was also this really distinct separation or distinction. The Jews were good people and they were God's people. The Gentiles, and the Gentiles, anyone who's not Jewish, they were bad and God will never love them. Jesus, again, what Paul's saying is Jesus changes everything and he gives worth to everyone. Jesus levels the playing field and says, you are all welcome in my house. I have no favorites. You're all invited. You're all my favorite. The poor, the slave, the outcast, the Gentile, all have a place reserved at my table right beside the rich and the favored, the athlete, the clumsy, the blue collar, the white collar, the clean, the dirty, the homeowner and the homeless. Like, social status and good or bad behavior are irrelevant. Anyone, all of you are invited. You are invited to humbly accept Jesus' sacrifice and make him your leader. Now, when Paul says this, or when Jesus, when this happens, like, this is radical. Like, this is radical. Paul goes on in verse 29 to say, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Okay, let me explain this. In the simplest of terms, without a long historic explanation, Abraham was the father of the Jewish nation, of the Hebrews, right? He was the father and began the Hebrew nation, the ones who were favored by God and were given the Ten Commandments, okay? Paul says, if you belong to Christ, even if you're not born a Jew or a Hebrew, if you belong to Christ, you've given yourself and all your faith is in Jesus, then you are of Abraham's seed. Does that mean then you become Jewish? Absolutely not. What that means is this movement that God began to bless the world, you are now, you're not Hebrew, you're not Jewish, you are one of God's. That's what this means. God, you are one of God's chosen people. You are his, all right? So, and so he says, if you've given your faith to Jesus, you now belong to God's family. That's the short answer. And he says, you are heirs according to the promise. Well, what's the promise? Again, short answer. Well, the promise is from Abraham, out of the line of Abraham will come one who will bless not just the nation of Israel, but will bless all of the nations, all people, and we become heirs to that, right? And that one person is Jesus. From Abraham comes Jesus. Jesus changes everything. Jesus makes it possible for all people to be God's people if they choose Jesus. The cross makes it possible for all people to be in the line of Abraham if they choose Jesus. And we become heirs. Heirs to what? If we're God's and we are heirs, like, something's coming to us, what's coming to us? All of it. All of God's promises. And the one we think of the most is the promise of eternal life in heaven, welcomed by God in heaven, welcomed by him who is our Father, right? So in Christ, listen, you could be, if you are in Christ now, you are a son or a daughter of God. Think about that. Think about that. You are a son or a daughter of the Creator, King of the universe. That's pretty cool to think about. Here's another big idea. You are a son or daughter of the Father God, and He is a good Father. For those of you who had great dads, your great dad is just a small taste of just how good and how great God the Father is. For those of you who had lame dads or absent dads or abusive dads, listen, they do not represent God in any way. God is the Father that you wish you had. The Father who perfectly loves you no matter what. He is the Father who thinks you are worth it. Like, He's not the kind of Father who will just disappear and never return. He's not the kind of Father who might one day say, I don't love you anymore. I don't want anything to do with you. He's not the kind of Father of abandonment and neglect and abuse and pain. He's not the kind of Father who's too busy or distracted to be with you. Listen, God, the Father, is constant, and He's constantly with you. And constantly loves you. And sometimes He disciplines you because He loves you and straightens you out and tries to correct you when you need it for your own good because He loves you. He's kind and He's gentle and He's not mad at you. He's mad for you. He loves you. God is the one you hoped for. He offers the love you've been looking for. And He gives you the identity. He gives you the label that cannot be taken from you in Christ, that you are a son and a daughter of the King. You are a son and daughter of the King of the universe. And there should be some confidence that comes out of that. A subtle strength that comes from knowing that. Like I'm a son of the King of the universe. Bring on the world. Bring on trouble. That's my dad. That's my dad, right? There's a comfort and there's a security in that. And it changes. It actually supersedes all of the other labels and all the other stigmas that you've been given. You're not who people tell you you are. You are who God tells you you are. And He says, you're mine, and I love you. I made a way for you to be mine through Jesus. You're my son. You're my daughter. He's my dad. J.I. Packer again says this. The guy we read earlier, he says, you can sum up the whole of the New Testament religion if you describe it as the knowledge of God as one's holy Father. If you want to judge how well a person understands Christianity, then find out how much he makes of the thought of being God's child and having God as his Father. We in Christ can say, that's my dad. That's my dad. And like little children, like me when I was 4, 5, 6, 7, look, we don't obey the rules and the Ten Commandments in order to be a child of God. We already are. Instead, like little children, we do the things God does because we want to be like our dad. Because that's our dad, and he's good, and he loves me. He saved me for this. Let's pray. Father God, without you, we are nothing. We are lost, broken, messed up, trying to find our identity and purpose here on this earth. But in you, through Christ, your only Son, who sacrificed himself so that we could be made sons and daughters again, we are all right, and we are yours. And for those who are here this morning who do not know that, Father, help us somehow to sink in and soften their heart. Help them find themselves drawn to you, looking for not just a good Father, but the perfect Father. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain. I wouldn't trade it for anything, 'cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story of you. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I would now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness, and I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I would know your heart, and I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. I can see said that you would pour your spirit out.
Us of what that's like before we leave.